Hi, friends. For a very long time, I couldn't figure out how to approach the topic of SCP-3000. It's such a unique object that I'm just gonna start talking about it. The first thing to know is that it's Thaumiel class. The very fact that such anomalies exist is secret, and information about them is only available to members of the O5 Council. This is the first reason why the story of SCP-3000, or as it's also known, Enantashisha, is so exciting. Gaining access to the files of secure class objects is one thing, but stealing secret information from the Foundation is another thing entirely. SCP-3000 resembles a huge moray eel. The exact length of its body is unknown, but presumably ranges from 600 to 900 kilometers long. For comparison, the length of the coastline of Jamaica is 1,022 kilometers. The object has a head with a diameter of 2.5 meters, and in some places, its body can be up to 10 meters thick. The serpent, or rather, most of it, is currently located in the subterranean outlet of the Ganges River, in the Bay of Bengal, at a depth of about 700 meters. An area of water spanning 300 square kilometers is patrolled by Foundation ships. The eel's head is monitored by a specially trained crew on the Aramita submarine. They're very lucky that SCP-3000 hardly moves. The creature is able to move the front part of its body very quickly, but it does this mainly for feeding, and it only eats people. Meanwhile, it doesn't need food to function. What it does to the people it devours is a whole other horror story. SCP-3000's anomalous properties affect all people, and there's no protection against them. The object carries a Class 8 cognitohazardous risk. It causes sharp and severe headaches, panic attacks, paranoia, unreasonable fear, suicidal ideation, and also complete or partial memory loss or replacement of memories. The effect manifests itself not only during direct eye contact with the creature, but at a distance as well. The radius of its influence is unknown, and the changes themselves are irreversible. All employees who fall under the influence of SCP-3000 are placed in Zone 151 for life, and therefore, the personnel of the Aramita submarine are chosen very carefully. Employees who leave the ship without permission are considered dead. Any interaction with the Enantashisha, other than the execution of the ADZAC protocol, is strictly prohibited. The existing protocol is extremely important for the Foundation, and consists of no less terrible actions. The Foundation became aware of SCP-3000's existence in 1971. At the time, two rowboats with 15 fishermen from Bangladesh disappeared off the coast of India. The story attracted attention because of the country's strained relations with Pakistan, who was suspected of being involved in the ship's disappearance. Scientists from the SCP Foundation learned about the disappearance, and during the course of the investigation, they discovered a gigantic biological mass in the Bay of the Bengal. An exploratory submarine was immediately sent down to the object. Its dive down to SCP-3000 was described by Dr. Eugene Getz. The entire crew immediately felt the object's effect, but a biologist named Williams felt the worst of it. The rest of the crew were mimetically prepared. William started sweating profusely, forgetting orders, and getting confused. Then, he fell silent, and even stopped blinking. Then, when the employee established visual contact with the creature's head, he started to bark like a dog and literally lost his mind. He smashed his head against a porthole, leaving behind cracks in the glass. When the submarine rose to the surface, Williams was already dead. His last words were, "There's nothing." Dr. Getz himself reported that he continues to see the eel's eyes and feels unreasonably afraid, like he did during the dive. Despite the dangerous consequences of that first experience, the first divers were sent down to Enantashisha. It was then that they came to know about the substance known as Y-909. Three deep-sea divers from the MTF Orion 9 group plunged into the bay on the submarine Stravinsky. They put on their diving suits, took their flashlights, and went out through the ship's airlock. As an insurance policy, the commander of the O9 group, Operative Alpha, was hooked to a cable, and Operatives Foxtrot and Bravo were hooked to its branches. The divers entered the bay 5 meters above the eel's head. At this point, Foxtrot already reported that he didn't remember how to turn on the flashlight. Then, the operatives mixed up their call signs, and the commander forgot what the mission was all about. Visibility underwater was 3 meters, so the group was guided by employees from the base. When they reached the 150-meter distance from the object, the creature moved in the direction of the operatives. Foxtrot started to rave about the darkness, the abyss, and two lone eyes. When the base realized that the group needed to be extracted, it was already too late. Operative Bravo remained relatively conscious and confirmed direct visual contact with the object. Then he reported that the creature had swallowed Operative Foxtrot whole. There were long periods of silence on the air. Enantashisha wrapped himself around the lifeline and tore the winch from its mountings on the ship. Bravo managed to detach himself from his branch of the cable and was left alone in the pitch darkness. He reported his feelings on the radio connection. According to him, the brain stops formulating thoughts near the eel. The operative compared this feeling to death. He also said that he saw the serpent right inside his head. After devouring two people, SCP-3000 remained open-mouthed and stopped moving. Suddenly, a gray slime started to form around its head, spreading about a meter away from the creature's body. Bravo managed to take a sample of the substance, later named eel jelly. Feeling its strong psychological influence, he was unable to send for help. It was impossible to approach the operative on the submarine. His radio stopped working after 3 days. It turned out that this viscous gray goo, that is Y-909, begins to exude from SCP-3000's head after feeding. The mechanism of its emergence is unknown. A study of the sample obtained by Operative Bravo of Orion 9 showed that the substance has a huge impact on brain activity. In particular, it increases suggestibility and erases memory. After careful study and purification, they began to use the substance for the production of amnesiacs. It's now an ingredient in 5 different classes of drugs, 3 experimental amnesiacs, and at least 2 classified drugs. The use of Y-909 made amnesiacs 78% more stable at low temperatures and 52% more stable at room temperature, compared to their counterparts without mucus. In addition, the substance released by the eel reduces both the physiological and psychological side effects of amnesiac use. Adding it to the drugs got rid of the nausea, migraines, blurred vision, insomnia, and obsessive memories. Side effects don't appear for a decade after treatment. Scientists have still not been able to synthesize an analog of Y-909. The Foundation doesn't want to return to more low-grade amnesiacs either, therefore, the ATSAC protocol was created. It regulates the collection of the substance released by SCP-3000. Of course, the protocol is considered absolutely unacceptable by the Ethics Committee, all because of the human sacrifice. It turned out that Y-909 is released only after the object has devoured a person. Class D personnel are used for this purpose. The employee is injected with a sedative and towed to SCP-3000 with the help of a radio-controlled device. The device returns to the Aramita submarine, and the eel's behavior is monitored from there. After devouring its victim, the creature starts to secrete the mucus. It's collected by specially trained divers for 2.5 hours after feeding. Observations have shown that during this period, SCP-3000's influence on people's consciousness is lower than usual. The Foundation is developing guided vehicles to replace the divers, but human sacrifice is unavoidable, since the compound is released only after its feeding, and it eats people exclusively. Actually, SCP-3000 just devours them. Radiography of the creature's body showed that it was completely stuffed with undigested human bodies. All of this allows us to draw quite definitive conclusions, but before we get to them, I want to tell you about Venkatraman Krishnamurthy, a Foundation research associate. While working on the Aramita submarine, he tried to make an unauthorized exit from the airlock without a diving suit. The doctor was detained and then interviewed by psychologist Anand Manava. Krishnamurthy reported several memory lapses or memory replacement. According to him, he saw other people's dreams and people he didn't know. He forgot whether he had a family and what he had been doing at work for many years. The doctor also said that there was something else on the ruins of his mind, an eel. Krishnamurthy recounted a story he heard as a child about the god Anantashisha. This is a huge, 6-headed serpent, the king of all reptiles. It exists in the cosmos, and on it lies the god Vishnu. Anantashisha, or Endless Shisha, existed before the beginning of the ages, and it alone will remain after the disappearance of the universe. The scientists believe that SCP-3000 was Anantashisha, and that its mind-destroying effect is the result of an encounter with God. Krishnamurthy was afraid that he had not left a mark on Earth, and that he would be forgotten. And the acquired fragments of someone else's memory led him to believe that the eel preserves the memories of the people it devours. 2 days later, Krishnamurthy was released from surveillance and was let out of the secure cabin. But 3 hours later, he made an unauthorized exit from the airlock to meet the god. But when SCP-3000 gaped over the door, he screamed that he had made a mistake, and that the eel was not Anantashisha. After that incident, Dr. Manava tried to find the cause of Krishnamurthy's suicidal thoughts. This was necessary for further training of the submarine's personnel. In the course of his research, the scientist realized that, like the others, he was losing his memory. But then he discovered that the photo of his family on the shelf wasn't really his. Manava did not have a spouse or children. And the photos, like the memories of the captured moment, belonged to Krishnamurthy. It was a picture of the deceased's first wife and daughter, Shanti and Padma. After that, Minerva understood exactly how SCP-3000 works. It decomposes the minds of the people it devours, partially materializing them in its gray slime. It also probably emits electromagnetic waves that spread the memories it receives over long distances, because the human thought process consists of, among other things, electrical impulses. In the last entry of Minerva's diary, he wrote that SCP-3000 could either be a primitive creature who hates consciousness or an ancient god. However, it doesn't harbor any evil, but simply demonstrates the end of everything. After this entry, the doctor opened the container of Y-909 and ate a large amount of the substance. According to records, the victim was taken to Zone 151. Now you know why I called SCP-3000 a unique object. In addition to that, it's Thaumiel class. Indeed, the Foundation contains other creatures that are considered gods, but like most of them, Anitashisha knows no sign of direct aggression and hardly moves. In the grand scheme of eternity, he's got nowhere to hurry. Personally, I'm very impressed by and even afraid of SCP-3000.
Everybody wants to rule the world.